Good morning, everybody. I have no electricity in my van right now. All my electrical systems have been all pulled out. So today, we're gonna do a bit more electrical work. And maybe today's the day where we get some of this stuff back together and can have some lights, because as of right now, using my cell phone is, well, really all I got. Oh, my coffee drawers are outside. Here's some sugar.
This is the second video in a multi-video series about upgrading my electrical system in my van to 4 100-amp-hour SOK marine-grade batteries. They have Bluetooth inside, and we'll dive into that app in this video. But also stick around, you guys, because I know electrical is a bit hard to understand, and today I ask Rainer a few questions along the way to help clarify some of the things that he was doing to my van, which I think might help some of you guys.
Good morning, SOK batteries. We are putting you inside the van today. Oh, super pumped about getting a good battery in my van. All right, let's make some coffee. This little French press thing makes a pretty damn good cup of coffee. Oh, good morning, crazy. I see you're already sitting on your love seat, buddy. Good morning. Choosing to run SOK as my battery source for the biggest power upgrade my van has ever had took a fair amount of research and decision, because there are so many options online right now for affordability for running lithium iron phosphate in your van. But these guys have been so highly reviewed by some pretty big channels, and that's why I chose them. These things are so comparative to some of the other heavy hitter battery companies on the market right now, but the price point on these is so affordable for the average person. Some of those other batteries are insanely expensive. That's the website there if you guys wanna check out all the technical jargon. Will Prowse also made a pile of videos on this one here, which is probably where you're gonna get your best breakdown on what the battery is actually like. But yeah, this is what I chose to throw in my home. 400 amp hours of SOK power is going in there. Something really awesome is that these things have an internal battery monitor system that you can view via Bluetooth. So in my van, I do run a Victron Energy battery monitor system, which is what I'll use to get a look at my overview of my whole system. But these will allow me to see each individual battery and exactly what's happening with each battery. So currently, right out of the box, this thing is at 77% state of charge. The voltage is 13.32. Its rated capacity is 100 amp hours, and it's currently 18 degrees Celsius inside that battery, which is absolutely epic for me to be able to see what the individual battery temps are in each of them. But this app gets way, way better. You click on the top, you go to detail. This breaks down the entire inside of the battery. It'll tell you that it was manufactured on the sixth month, first day of 2022. Designed voltage, 12.8 volts. Actual capacity is more than what it's rated right here. The actual capacity of the cells is 103.9 amp hours, which is insanely awesome. I love it when battery companies do that. Or better than rating it 100 amp hours and you get in here and it's only 96, you know what I mean? And here's where I find this is awesome. So there is four cells in here, side by side. You can actually see the cells, each individual cell. So it'll tell me if I've had a cell break or anything like that. So you can see the entire detail of the inside right here inside the app that comes with these SOK batteries, which I think is absolutely epic. To have an app as detailed as this, for me to be able to see what the battery temperatures are in those compartments, is amazing in my situation. So I've chosen to put my batteries in each back corner of the vehicle, and we're heating the compartments with my van's already existing Wabasto dry air heating system. So what we did in a video the other day is we took the single duct that used to come out into the van to heat the main part of the van, and we put a splitting system on there so I can actually just turn a dial and adjust how much I want put into those each individual battery compartments to make sure that the batteries stay at the proper temperature in the winter season so we can charge them when it's super cold outside. No big deal. We just turn on my van's heater because you can discharge those batteries when they're cold. You just can't charge them. By the time my van's good and warm for me to get up for the day, so will my batteries be ready to take on a charge, which is really cool to be able to pull up an app and see exactly what the battery temperatures are. The battery system I have in my van that monitors everything is a Victron battery monitor shunt, which means everything in my van that pulls power from my system goes through the Victron battery monitor shunt so I can see exactly what's going on in my system. But now with an app like this one, I could see what's going on in my system right down to the cell level of the system, which is crazy cool. These SOKs are turning out to be way more impressive than they looked when I looked them up online. This app was like, are you serious? Like, I can see the cells. That's so cool to me. I used to run these little steely mounts all around my van for my phone. And on the back of my old cell phone, I used to have the magnet side so I could click it to these little balls. But I found having the magnet on the back of my phone was just like a giant pain. So I picked these up from Moment Lenses. So Moment is a company that makes lenses for iPhones, and they have these little MagSafe mounts. And I thought they were awesome because most phones now have MagSafe charging, which means the back of them are magnetic. So I picked up a couple of these for around my van, and I'm gonna stick one where this steely ball used to be. Bada boom. All right. I was thinking about making these actual charging ones and hardwiring them right in, but for the amount of time that I would need to throw my phone up and charge it every time, it's just not that important. But having little places to put your phone just come in handy. Like, that's great there.
Many years ago, Ray Outfitted installed the solar and stuff on my roof and my charge controller and stuff, but I installed the rest of my electrical. I installed my batteries, my switches, all my lights. So today, having Rainer dig through all my work has me a little nervous.
Oh, mounting those upright look way better. So much sleeker from the front side here. I don't have to see all the plugs and stuff. And Rainer has also moved my shore charging unit that I have there, which is the NOCO 50 Pro. That was underneath my driver's seat. You guys seen that in an install video I did in the backcountry there, but that looks super sleek. From where all my electrical is in the front, you'll notice that right along the bottom side of all my drawers behind the cabinet, there was a section left where all my electrical is in there. Everything, every cable that runs to the back is all run through here, keeping the accessibility so you can fix things super easy, pop out two drawers and you have access to either pulling out a cable, fixing something. We also did the same thing for when it came to running all my little puck lights and things up along the roof. Everything here is all done behind these little, what these are, just little kickboards for people's homes. Yeah, pop open a few screws, that comes down exposing all the wires that are run along the top. I have nothing buried behind my walls anywhere at all, making things easy to repair or to add to if needed. That is a smart thing to do if you guys are building a van. Always think about having accessibility to all your electrical. Instead of calling those a bus bar, is that a bus post?
It's a junction post. They can also be called a bus bar, especially these ones, because they have a bunch of little ones around the outside.
Oh yeah, sweet.
It's just
that's cool.
Yeah. Just so it makes it nicer for all the connections to meet.
Mm-hmm. That looks really good in there. Wow, everything's all tucked away. The last time all that stuff was just like dangling there.
I tried to tuck it in the back so you wouldn't see it, but then, you know, just comes out, and that looks really good, man.
When you got somebody professional diving into the electrical system that you initially started on your own is a little scary for someone like me, because then you get someone who knows what they're doing, seeing what I did in the past and how I originally wired my home. And we also get to find little parts that I installed a long, long, long time ago for alternator charging. And it was this little
battery isolator.
There you go. I don't have my glasses on, bro. Thank you. And what this thing did was, and it was cheap. These things were like $50, $60 or something like that. What it is when your alternator kicks on and your starter battery is above charge, this will turn on and send power to the back. But we're going to cut these weak links out because we don't want anything like this kind of failing, blocking off any power that could be going back to my proper electrical system now. This stuff had it had its time in my van, but this should have been tossed out of here a long time ago. We're putting two batteries in that corner, two batteries in that corner, and we're heating those chambers by a ducting system inside of the van, running off of my Wabasto dry air heater. So this was normally just plumbed right up here to the front, and then I could adjust where I wanted the airflow to go, but that was it. So in a video the other day, Ray Outfitted put a ducting system in here to duct it down to that corner, and another one comes through here, winds around, and goes into that back battery compartment, and they're all run off some dials down here. So you can turn the dial to adjust how much heat you want to leak into that back corner. And that's pretty much what it is. It'll just be letting a tiny little bit of heat back there because that's a really tiny space to heat up, and allowing a majority of the heat to come out the front to heat my home itself. It's a really cool thing, not only to heat the battery compartment, but because I have all of this honeycomb stuff throughout my entire bottom of my whole bed, everything in here has airflow through the entire thing. So heating a little bit behind the bed will actually warm this entire bottom area, which in turn may keep my bed a little bit warmer, which is really kind of cool just to have a heated system underneath the bed, not only for the batteries. So yeah, so after it's all been ducted, I'm gonna go through here right now. Rainer has handed me some of these clamps, so we're just gonna clamp all the ductwork down. This thing's actually taking a ton of these little clamps. So I'm just screwing these things on every single connection. And these ones are awesome. You just gotta turn the dial on the top, no screwdriver needed. They're pretty cool. So if you look at this cable here, it comes up to this little device. This thing here is what controls how much heat comes through this pipe into this back battery compartment. It's actually a really cool little system. Little box here is my Wii Boost. It's my cellular signal booster, and it works. I really like it. I'm just not one to want to stay near cell service these years, so it's become less of an important addition to my van. But Rainer's going to be mounting it in a new location up there. And so if you're wondering what that black thing is on the top of my van right in the middle, that's the Wii Boost antenna. And this one here is the inside one. So the Wii Boost is really good. Like if you're in areas where you're gonna have cell service that possibly might drop out in certain areas, and just keep the Wii Boost on the whole time just to give you the strongest signal, it works great. But these days I'd rather be in the bush away from any phone calls. Yeah, except for a Starlink, except for you need to work. We are gonna set up camp right outside the shop here and make some food.
If you're thinking about installing your own electrical system in your own camper van, great, good on you, especially if you know what you're doing. I have a basic understanding, but still, once you get so many different components together and different gauges of wire and different fuse sizes, this is where it gets a little bit confusing for me. I was always told that if you can't schematically draw out your whole van's electrical system before you install it and understand every component and every gauge of wire, you should probably call a professional. And I love that statement. I think there's a lot of truth to that.
We've got our four batteries in the back here now. Now we have to have a junction spot where all the batteries meet together. So we've got a coil of wire here that I can use to run through where the cables are going to be, so I know exactly what length to make all of my battery cables.
So in this shot, you guys can definitely see how much airflow runs in and around underneath my bed because of doing the little honeycomb here. It's just super nice to know that it's not just a sealed in wood compartment and everything in there is just stale dead air, that there's actually air moving around under here, which is really awesome.
If you're going to DIY a system like this on your own, make sure you do a ton of research. There's lots of great information out there that'll help you choose the right gauge wire for the amount of current you're running through it.
Choosing the right wire is super important in your van, because if you undergauge the wire and it's trying to shove a lot of freaking power through it, that's where you can cause a fire. Or if you have different gauges along the way and then one is under gauge, that's gonna be your weak point and gonna be the fuse that's gonna start your whole van on fire. So I was looking at these cables here that he's running to my batteries and I'm like, aren't those look a little small? I myself would picture something a little bit more thicker and beefier. Why are we not going with something huge like this giant bugger right here?
And the reason why is because each battery is going to be wired in parallel on its own. So we've got two cables going to each battery. And because each battery only has to put out a maximum of 60 amps in your system, this wire is still overgauged for what we're doing.
So if you were to run them right next door to each other in a bank side by side,
then you would do, with the amount of current that you have going back and forth, you would use a one gauge, linking all the batteries together. For this, we're going with multiple 8-gauge wires to meet into the 1-gauge and go up to the front.
Having all these holes in here has turned out to be like a lifesaver in some ways for a lot of things. Anytime you need to run a cable, there's a bazillion holes to run a cable through, which is kind of cool. You guys quite often hear me talking about my Victron battery monitor, the app that you guys see that gives me a full overview of my entire system. This little thing is the brain behind what I see on that app.
We're finalizing all the battery connections here in the back, and we're about to install the shunt. And as we can see on the two sides, the one says battery only, and the other says load and charger. So you want just your battery connections on this side and everything else on this side. The reason for that is this little PCB board here monitors everything going through the black fins here. So that's how we know exactly how much power is left in the batteries, because it's monitoring all the ins and outs that go through here to tell us through our battery monitor what the health of the batteries are. What we're doing here is each battery is getting its separate fuse. The reason we're doing this is because we're using smaller gauge wire going back to the batteries. If one of the batteries fails or if something happens, we want that battery not to be able to send out any more power. So if three of these batteries die, we don't want one battery being taxed with trying to send out all the power. It's going to pop the fuse, and then Chrome's going to know he has an issue with his system.
And then we should have... Want me to go plug the fridge in?
Sure.
That was the fan for sure. All right, so we've been running my fridge off the Jackery here while we've been working on the van. We got fridge power, good to go. It's no longer plugged into the Jackery. We got some lights on in the house.
The rear fan.
Perfect. Thanks for watching today's video, everybody. We're gonna leave this one right here. And now that my 12 volt system is all up and running, on the next video, Ray Outfitted here will be wiring up all of my power that needs my inverter, including my speakers, my Starlink, and a bunch of other little things. And we're getting switches, little switches in the van that I can turn on little items that are required on the inverter, which I never had before. Before, it was just extension cords and power bars and super cheesily done. So I'm pretty stoked to see this thing all wrapped up. So on the next video as well too, I'll get Rainer here to walk us through the system and also a deeper look into the Victron battery monitor app, and also having a good look at the app inside of the SOK batteries, because those things are run by Bluetooth, which I'm actually very stoked about. Anyway, guys, come back for the next one. Say bye, Rainer.
Bye.
See you guys.